Hello everyone, welcome to Magnetized Lab. Today we are here with a new video. We will discuss about STM32 development board design with CAN, GPIOs and USB-Type-C interface. STM32 is a 32-bit MCU family from ST Microelectronics. Today we will see F103 series. It has two variants, C8T6 which is 64 KB flash and CBT6 which is 128 KB flash. Both has native USB, native CAN, 7 timers, 2 ADC channels and other communication interfaces like I2C, SPI, USART, etc. The package is LQFP48 pin, 7x7mm size, and it comes under medium density devices because of the flash size. STM also offers low density and high density devices based on the flash size. So based on your application and program size, you can go for MCUs accordingly. Let's move to the block diagram. So I have divided the MCU section into three parts, CAN, UART and GPIO. I have used the native CAN pins, CAN RX and TX. I have converted that to CAN high and low using a CAN transceiver, and I have given that to a connector which will connect to any other external CAN peripheral for communication. I have not used native USB because the MCU provides same pins for USB and CAN, so we can only use one thing at a time, maybe native USB or native CAN. So I have used native CAN here, and I have used USR channel 1 and I have converted that to USB using a USBTypeC bridge. I have used a Type-C connector because it's widely used these days in mobile chargers and other things. You will find very easily you will find Type-C cables and connectors. So I have used that. Here the Type-C connector will provide two functions. One, the main function is to supply power to the board. The secondary function which it can also do is that it can be used as a programming method if you adjust the boot jumpers in the development board. All other GPIOs I have given on the headers. Now let's move to the schematic. This is our schematic. This is how the schematic looks like. Let's zoom into the input power section, which is type C. I have used an ESD protection diode here for USB. I've also used it for CAN. So ESD protection diode basically helps us to clamp any voltage surges on the pins so that it doesn't damage our transceiver and USB UART bridge or any other circuitry which is connected to it. I have used an LED indication here for input supply so that whenever you plug in the USB cable, this LED will glow and it will let us know that the power is properly coming to the board. This is USB Type-C connector. On the VBUS rails, I have added decoupling capacitors. So decoupling capacitors is to reduce noise on the supply rails. I have shorted CC1 and CC2 pins and I have pulled it low to ground to make it work in device mode so that it can take power from any host. This you can read more about it in the data sheet. Then I have connected DP and DN pins to USB D plus and D minus. Ground pin and the shield pin I have shorted and I have connected to the ground. Now let's go to the LDO section. Here I'm converting 5 volts to 3V3 for the MCU. This is your input pin. I have connected decoupling capacitors again here. I have also connected decoupling capacitors on the output rail. I want constant voltage, so I have used the adjustment pin. I have connected the adjustment pin to ground. That's all about LDO. I have used a debug LED for the MCU section so that you can easily test that the MCU section is working properly or not. In the MCU, I have connected necessary peripherals for the crystal oscillator. I have used 8 MHz crystal here, 1 mega ohm resistor for it and 2 12 picofarad capacitors. For reset pin, I have connected a switch. For all the 3V3 rails, I have connected 0.1 microfarad capacitor for decoupling. And here you can see SW clock and SWDIO pins. This is for programming. Then CAN TX and CAN RX I have given to the CAN transceiver, which I will explain later. MCU RX and MCU TX also I have given to the USB UART bridge. Apart from that, all other GPIOs I have given to spare GPIO header. Boot 0 and boot 1 I have connected to the boot jumpers, which I was talking about. Here, I have connected boot 0 and boot 1 using 100 kilo ohm resistor. And this is for setting the MCU in different modes. So here you can see SWDIO and clock and reset pin. This is for programming. These both headers are 2x3 headers. And these headers are for spare GPIOs, which is 1x15 header, two headers, 1x15. Let's go to CAN comms now. This is the input CAN TXRX. CAN TXRX are based on the MCU voltage levels, which is 3.3 volt. And CAN HNL is based on 5 volt levels. And then I have given this to a connector for external communication. And let's go to USB-UART bridge. So I have connected MCU-RX-TX here. And then, so I have used CB2102N for USB-UART conversion. And here you can connect USB-D plus and D minus. All the supply pins I have connected decoupling capacitors. For reset pin, I have pulled it high using a 2 kilo ohm resistor. For suspend pin, I have pulled it low using a 10 kilo ohm resistor. This is as per the data sheet. That's all about schematic. Let's go to the PCB. This is how the PCB looks like. Yeah. So I have made a 4-layer PCB because I wanted impedance matched traces for CAN and USB. I have made CAN as 120 ohm impedance matched traces and USB as 90 ohm impedance matched. I'll explain line by line. Let me show you first the 3D view of the PCB, which will be easier to explain. So the board dimensions are clear here, 65x60 mm. This is your input supply type C connector. This is your LED for indication of input supply. This is your ESD protection diode for USB signals. This is CP2102. This is the MCU section, STM32. This is the LDO I have used for 5 volt to 3.3 volt conversion. This is crystal oscillator and other crystal oscillator peripherals. This LED is the debug LED I was explaining earlier. This is boot jumper header. Based on this, you can set the modes for the MCU. This is CAN transreceiver IC. This is the programming header. This is the switch for resetting the MCU. I have also given this pinout here for this programming header so that people don't get confused with the pinout, which is first pin, second pin. And these headers I have given for all the spare GPIOs. I have added 5 volt, 3.3 volt and ground, as well as other spare GPIOs which are left in the MCU, so that you can easily connect any other daughter card or any other peripheral to it. Next is this connector, which is for the external CAN peripheral. I have given proper labels for it, as you can see. Like if something externally needs to be connected to this connector, they can easily connect it by seeing the labels. They don't have to refer to the schematic for this. For USB, I have not given anything because it's a standard USB cable which comes with it. I've added logo for Magnetized Lab. You can add your own logo here. And this is the back side of the PCB. Please make sure that the gap between the mounting holes and the dimensions of the PCB overall is a whole number. It's not a decimal. It's easier for developing enclosures for it. So that's about the 3D part of it. Let's go to the PCB design now. So I'll disable all the layers first and I'll explain line by line. So these are all the components which were used. So let's see. Layer 1, which is ground plus signal. So I'll explain from here. This you can see there's a very thick trace for 5 volt. I've added a 0.5 mm trace. Because I have not made it a plane, so I wanted a proper heat dissipation, and for the supply rail, it's good to have 0.5 mm trace width. Then I have added impedance match traces for USB here. You can see USB plus and minus. Then Then this is the MCU section. Then I have added impedance matrices for CAN HNL, which goes through the connector and then to the diode, ESD protection diode. That's majorly about it. Then I'll show you the second layer, which is ground. So it's good practice that when you have impedance matched traces in the top layer, you should have the next layer to it. The adjacent layer should be ground for proper ground reference. So I've added first layer as impedance matched traces. So I've added second layer as ground. And third layer I've added as 3v3. So I wanted 3v3 everywhere for all the peripherals and for the MCU. So I have made third layer as 3v3. And I have taken vias on from the top layer where I have added MCU, and I have taken to the third layer for connections. Fourth layer is again ground plus signal. So suppose you made fourth layer as impedance match traces, then you should keep third layer as ground reference. This is a very good practice which you should follow. That's all about the PCB. Okay, I'll show you the stack up for this now. So this is how the stack up looks like. You can give a board name. I have given here STM32 CAN USB board. It's a four layer board, and you can make a template like this for your PCB fabrication. All the four layers are 35 micron. The total board thickness is 1.6 mm, which is standard. Material used is FR4, rectangle, and 60 x 65 mm is the dimension for the board. I have kept silk screen and solder mask standard, which is white and green. I need impedance control, so I have said yes here. Delivery days and number of PCBs is very specific to you. I generally go for any gold finish. You can go for whatever finish you like. Then here comes the main part, which is impedance control details. So as I already told, first layer, if it is impedance matched traces, then the second layer should be reference for it. So this is for CAN. For 120 ohm impedance requirement, I have used 0.1 mm trace width and 0.43 mm trace to trace gap. For USB, for 90 ohm impedance, I have used 0.13 mm trace width and 0.12 mm trace to trace gap. These numbers are given by the PCB manufacturer. So you can get in touch with any PCB fabrication entity. They will give their own numbers based on their capabilities and tools, whatever they are using for fabrication. That's all about it. Yeah. So if you have any questions or if I have missed something in the video, please let us know. Please comment down below and we are very happy to help you. Thank you so much.